1, 2, 3. Testing. 1, 2, 3. One, two, three. Testing. One, two, three, testing. Don't tell me I'm having trouble here now. Testing. 1, 2, 3. One, two, three. Testing. Can anybody hear me? I don't think my audio is working. Testing. 1, 2, 3. Something's going on with my audio here. And 1, 2, 3. One, two, three, testing. I don't know why my audio is not coming through, folks. It's be coming through loud and clear. For some reason. One, two, three, testing. Can you hear me now? I think you should be able to hear me now. At least I see big green bars here. I had to shut down my broadcast system and restart it. Testing. One, two, three. Check, check, check. Okay, that was it. One, two, three, testing. Okay, folks, I did change the battery in my microphone, but that didn't seem to be it. Once I shut down my broadcast software and brought it back up and started streaming again, I think it's coming through now. At least the green bars on my computer tell me it's going out, so you should be able to hear it fine. Okay, a couple more minutes and we'll get started. Start my cameras. Camera one, camera two, camera three, okay, folks, you can hear the clunking I'm doing. It's basically to synchronize my audio when I do the editing of these videos later. And it's about 1 minute till one by my time. Glad to see you're all here. Glad to see you can all hear me. And I don't know what happened to my software here. It had to be stopped and restarted, but once I restarted, it took off. So anyway, with that said, we're going to get going here. And I've been showing you for the last few minutes, 15 minutes or so, the painting we're going to do today. It's a scene from Cabo San Lucas in Mexico, and it was a painting that's actually a photograph that I picked up from one of my Facebook websites that actually provide photos for artists, so I'm able to take any photo off of this website and this Facebook page and paint them and reproduce them and sell them, whatever I want to do, with no copyright infringement. So it's a really nice Facebook page for artists. So this scene that I've been showing you was taken in Mexico, and a couple of the photographer, his name escapes me right now, but it's a photographer named Drew Forbes or Duffy have taken this photo. When you Google Cabo San Lucas, you don't really see this type of scene. So they say, they tagged this photo and said that's where it's from. So this is my photo we're going to paint today. I've had the grid up for you to look at for a while, and this is probably going to be more about rocks than about anything. So we'll be working on how to sculpt rocks, how to make them look three-dimensional, and put them into this seascape scene. I have also done my value map, which is fairly simple in this particular view, but the all the shades of value and shapes that are in those rocks is what's really going to be the challenge for today, I think. So with that, I'll show you my grid again, and I'll have this up on my website. I'll have the sketch for this on my website by the time I get an edited version. Actually, what happens is when I do this streaming, this video stays out on YouTube, and you can watch it. People can tune in and see it. And then sometimes if I'm not happy with the way the video comes across in the stream, I will actually re-edit the video. I have three cameras running that are all recording, so I have enough video and audio footage that if I want to redo this video for YouTube purposes, I can actually do it. That being said, I may or may not redo this video, but at least I'll have the footage that allows me to do it. So I think I'm ready to head over to the easel now, and we will get started here very quickly. Let me show you that scene, and I will move over to the easel. Okay, I don't have all my lights on yet. I only got one light left to be on. I got my cameras running, got my audio microphone on, and I have to get my computer here that has actually got the, where am I? Hold on just a second, folks. I've got to tune in here with you guys and see if I can. I have a computer up here by my easel that, there's my page I wanted. Okay, I see all your names, and I can see your text. If you type in something in caps, I will try to respond to it. I have a small laptop here by my easel, so that's what I was getting set up to look at to make sure I saw the same thing that I'm streaming out to you. So I'm sending out the stream, and I'm receiving it back, so up here by my easel, so I can look at it. So okay, so here's the photograph and the value map that I have at the top of my easel always, I just showed you on the computer. I also have a sketch here, and this is the sketch that's on tracing paper. I left it that way so you could see it. It's pretty light on the paper because I actually use some kneaded eraser to take it off. But I use this over some graphite transfer paper and trace it in. I use red ink on this so that I can see where I've gone, where I've traced when I'm putting it on my paper. So I have it on the paper. I know you can't see that very well, but I wanted to show you the sketch, and that sketch, a photograph of that sketch, will be on my website eventually. It won't be there today. It's not there right now, but it will be there soon. Okay, so how are we going to paint this thing? This is really going to be an interesting challenge with these rocks. If you've never seen kneaded eraser, it's this kind of eraser that's it's real mushy, and you can bend it around different shapes. And I use it to get some of this graphite off of the paper, so I don't have so much of that graphite transfer on here. But I can still see the outline of the major objects, and I can see the shapes and the places where I want to put shadows and that sort of thing. So with that said, let me flip over and go through my paints and brushes very quickly. Most of you, if you watch me often enough, you know this, but I have a set of Sterling Edwards brushes here. I have a small, medium, and large. These are large bristle brushes. I may not use all of those, but I will probably use
one or two of them. Have a couple of flats. I have a 1-inch flat and a 1/2-inch flat, a few rounds, a number 12 round, a number 8 round, and a number 4 round. And I have a couple of small rigger brushes here by American Painter that I may or may not use. I usually use one of those at least to sign my painting with. So that's my brushes, my paints. As I've described to you before, I'll go around here again one more time so you can hear what they are. These are my Mary Blue watercolors, and very nice Italian transparent watercolors. This color is neutral tint, very much like Payne's Gray. I have primary blue cyan, ultramarine blue, ultramarine violet, crimson lake, primary red magenta, cadmium red, burnt sienna, raw sienna, yellow ochre. Then I have cupric green and sap green. I have limon yellow, primary yellow. Inside row I have burnt umber, and I have still to grain brown and Auvignon orange. You also see a couple other paints over here that are pure black. I think this is lamp black and titanium white, both of which are supposed to be colors that are legal for transparent watercolors to use in their paintings. I probably won't use either of those today, but I was working on a painting that the collaborators were doing, and I was trying to experiment with just black and white to see what that looked like. We decided not to put those videos up right before Christmas. Everybody was so busy that we just stopped, and we're going to catch up our collaboration again shortly here. I'll put my palette overlay here, and with that, I think I'm going to get started. I want to get some clear water on this on here, and so I can soften the sky down to the water level. And just by putting clear water on will give us a nice soft sky. May not make it exactly the same color as the photograph, but I'll try to put something nice in there that is pleasing to look at. I actually put a couple sailboats and a couple of birds in there and stuff that wasn't in a photograph either, but we'll use that and to kind of amplify or add a little more to the painting here. I'm going to pick up some ultra blue, and I want a very, not a heavy sky, I want a fairly light sky. I'm just going to kind of brush it across here like this, and as I come down, less paint in the brush, it'll start leaving some light areas. I can even lighten it up a little bit by adding just by blotting my brush out a little bit. Maybe just a touch of alizarin in there to sort of redden it up at the base. Don't see the red. My brush is coming apart here. Sometimes these bristles spread out on you and you have to just kind of touching it like that, letting it run together. Keep a few light areas in there for sky, for clouds. Not trying to paint clouds exactly, I'm just trying to get some nice streaks. That's very light. It's going to lighten up even as I paint more. So I'm going to make it darker at the top, so let that run down again. The little bit of water that's in the paper, I didn't put a whole lot on there, but it's going to run down to wherever I stop the water. All right, not too much for that. That's fast and loose and simple and done. If I keep going back in there, I'll mess it up and I'll get some blossoms, or who knows what happens when you go over and over a sky. I really don't like to do that. The water below the sky is much darker. Pick up a little of my cyan blue and see if I can get a little bit of a different color in there. That's really dark. And I didn't wet that paper down below here, so I'm going to sort of just keep it like this. That's a little bit too much for the, should let that dry a little more. And as we come forward, it actually picks up just a touch of green in it. So I'm going to add a little sap green in there to get a little of this turquoise color. I don't know if you can see that well, but that's a little sap green. A big glob of green on there. Using a big 1-inch brush. Could be using something smaller, but I'm not. Give a few areas that look like there's some ripples in that water. I don't have to paint all those in. There's a big splash that's right here that I want to try to develop. But right now I just want to leave this kind of rough looking with. Paint around some rocks, leave some room for rocks. Put a little more of that green back in here in some areas. Darken it up just a little. Not too much. Okay. Maybe just a little more touch of this blue here to. Yes, it's getting a bit fuzzy on me. I'm not going to spend a ton of time on this sky and water. As you can imagine, I'm going to be spending my time on these rocks. So hopefully that gives you a bit of an idea of what's going on here. The water and everything here, that as it comes forward, is getting grayer. It's actually got a little bit of, put a little of this burnt sienna in it, and it will sort of gray this blue down. Blue and dark sienna, and or burnt sienna and blue will give you a grayish color. So that's kind of some of the color that's in here. It's not very gray right now. Gray it a little more there. Just using the corner of this brush. We'll come back and put in a few dark spots in here. That'll help put some shadow in under these little waves that are going on back here. It gets real frothy as it comes forward there. I'm going to stop on that now, I think. Leave that alone. The rocks I'm painting on, I forgot to tell you folks, I'm painting on 11 by 14 watercolor paper, and it's 300 pound A. Murphy ask here. It's not 140 pound arches, it's 300 pound Fabriano paper. Fabriano Artistico, which is kind of my favorite paper. The 300 pound really doesn't buckle. If I had 140 pound on here, it would be starting to buckle all over the place. So I like the 300 pound because it's pretty solid, and it doesn't buckle. Okay. Excuse me. I think I'll start on some of these rocks now, see if I can get this brownish color that we have. I'm going to use a little of my neutral tint and a little bit of my blue, a little bit of this brown. And just sort of lay in this rock here. Sorry, folks, I'm having a bit of a coughing fit here. This is sort of an undertone for this entire rock here. I'm going to come back and put some really dark spots in there and start sculpting it. These other rocks here have similar coloring on them to start with. There's one. Side of another one here. Probably should pick up a smaller brush. I get stubborn sometimes and just say, I'm going to see if I can do it with a big brush. But sometimes I wish I had taken a smaller brush. So I'm picking up a half inch flat here. And we'll come in and put in another lighter color here over the top. So I'm just kind of adding some water to it. So the sun is coming from the left, so the left side of these rocks are lighter than the right side. So for me to make my shadows properly in here, I have to now come back darker, as long as it's not going to blossom on me. Very light little dark marks here. It comes down to this other rock. I didn't even paint that rock in yet, but it's down there. Right here. I'm using neutral tint, a little bit of ultra blue and burnt sienna for these rocks. So that's that one. Let's see, this has got a big triangular section here that's sort of behind that rock. And there's another little section here, goes down into the water. Okay, so hopefully on camera that's looking like some big, nice big rocks sticking up out of the water with sun hitting them on the left side and giving you the kind of look that I'm trying to get here out of these rocks. Usually the bottom of the rocks where they touch the water are very, very dark. Almost black. If there is a black in nature, it would probably be under some rocks. Even though your camera may turn all of that black, it really wouldn't be that way if you were out there looking at it. So I can make these rocks more brown or more blue or more gray depending on what percentage of these colors I put in, whether it's more ultra blue, more burnt sienna, or more of the neutral tint. OK, Okay, so in here, I'm trying to carefully render these because these are what really make this thing stand out. And I'm taking a little more time with them than I might otherwise do. Sometimes you can just put in a, use a credit card and just scrape into these rocks, and sometimes it gives a nice rough texture on top of the rocks. But it's also hard to control, and it's hard to make it look exactly like you want if you're trying to sort of duplicate a scene of some sort. This rock. The other thing about rocks is typically they're very angular. These rocks, because they've been beaten up by the sea for who knows how long, have a lot of roundedness to them. And so that makes them a little different and a little tougher to paint sometimes, the roundedness, but you can get some nice soft edges like this part right here. I can just soften some of this, where that sharp edge is, and by just adding some water, clear water, just running the brush down that rough edge, or that hard edge, I can make it look softer. So I'm making it look rounded by just softening what was a hard edge. These up here are hard edges. They look angular, and that's really the way the photograph looks. But here, this rock is more rounded. So let's remove some of the hard edges and soften it up. This rock under here is more rounded as well. And also the brush strokes you use can help tell the viewer what's going on. But you always want to, in this case, we always want to make the right side much darker. So I'm getting my blues and my neutral tint and making the right side of this rocks much darker. Put a little blue in there maybe. Put a little blue in some of these. Okay, so that looks more like a rounded rock, rounded top on him. I'm getting a hard edge just developing there that you can start to see that makes it look a little more angular. Okay, Tim, thanks for your comment. He likes the shadows on the rocks. Yeah, that makes them stand out, that contrast between the light and dark really does make them stand out. I'm going to put another leather coat on this one. It was getting lost in the shuffle there. Okay. Now we have some other rocks that sort of stick up here. Sort of different. We'll let that dry and come back and put the shadows in. There are some dark shadows back in here. This rock is very light, a lightish brown. Where's the brown? I'm just trying to make this thing come to life for you as I paint left to right across the paper here. Making these rocks all stand out. Rock down here has got a little more gray in it. So I don't have to copy this photograph perfectly, but it is such an interesting and unique scene. I wanted to do it justice as much as I can. So
We can use a palette knife or a credit card to get the texture on the rocks. Also use the back of your the plastic. If you have a plastic edge on your paintbrush, you can do that sometimes as well. But you have to get it when it's just the right amount of wetness. If you wait too long, nothing happens. It just fills back in. If you get it just right, it will scrape out the paint and leave light areas. I'm sort of forcing all of this with the brush right now. Because I want it to have a certain look. If I just took a knife and scraped it, I would get something. It's a nice texture, but it might not be representative of what I'm really looking for. Okay, so it looks like I have a few rocks kind of stacked up there that are kind of being beaten and beaten apart. Dark down here, use my dark here again. And then some brown here. Light and dark. It's the contrast of the color and the value that makes these things look three-dimensional, makes them look real. Pick up a little of my still grain brown. I'm going to change my brown color a little bit instead of the, been using the burnt sienna. So I can change up my color. Let's see, I've got this big foamy thing here. This rock really sticks up here. Really very sort of a unique. If you see me turn around every once in a while and look back behind me here, I have a monitor that shows me what's going out to you guys on the video stream, so I can tell whether I'm painting underneath my palette over here. I have my palette sitting right here. If I get painting over that and I don't show you the palette, you won't see what's going on. So I keep checking to make sure I'm not getting out of whack over there. Okay, so there's sort of the front of the rock and the back of the rock. I don't know why that side of the rock. I think it must be caved in a little bit. Down here it's lighter in the light. So let's put it in the light. Another few light areas in here. Got a big rock right here. Kind of fun. It's almost therapeutic. It sort of makes you go into a trance while you're painting these rocks, because they're really kind of over and over the same thing, but everyone's different and you need to work on making sure you separate them so you can see the separation either through a light crack like that, or a lighter shade, or a lighter value, a lighter color. So I paint around the shadow of this one rock here, and I outline the rock below it. So when I come back, I can make it that to be a little rounded. Yeah, like that. Up here we have a very dark bottom. I've got burnt umber I can use.
is a very dark brown. I can stick it under here if I want a really dark color like this. So you see the sculpting, I call it, basically changing these, softening that edge. All of a sudden it looks like a rounded rock sitting up there, which it is. It's got a few little cracks and crevices in it here, some spots, but basically that's all there really is to that guy. A little darker at the bottom. So you notice I'm trying to get, if I can, trying to get three values in these rocks: light, medium, and dark. If you can do that on anything that's three-dimensional, you start getting the three-dimensional look. You don't have to have 10 value pattern, 10 shades of gray to make a value pattern to make something look three-dimensional. Usually three values will do it. Okay, I'm going to change a little more gray up here at the top. This guy is a little bit too much blue in him there. Back off, pick up some other brown. Almost too dark as well. So let's take some clear water and just sort of pull it up and back down. That little blue section out of there. There we go. Interesting color. I just put up some more blue in my palette and almost got too much of it there. Back side of this is going to be darker and painting wet on dry, and that lets me handle the water that's in the paper much easier than if this were all wet. Okay, that looks like a big rock sticking up there. So another light rock up here. These colors do dry lighter, about 20-30% lighter than when you put them on. So you always have to sort of play that game. You put them on darker than you really need them, because they are going to lighten up. That's one of the challenges with watercolor, is to how to make these things end up the color you want them. Dark, lighten that up. So if I want to lighten it up, I just take clear water and put the paint on the paper, and now I'm using clear water to just sort of blend it in, make it look like the face of the rock. So I got quite a pile of rocks there already. Got a lot more in here to bring down, but I hope you're not getting bored watching me paint rocks, but you can at least see the techniques I'm using kind of over and over. It's just I'm trying to make them all different and make them all more interesting than just all one set of square rocks or rectangular rocks or angular rocks. There's a dark one right there. Bring him down and sort of and I'm going to just sort of use clear water, lighten it up, pull it down.
little bit too much, a little bit too dark. Lighten it up. How do you do that? Take the pure water in the brush and just paint it like this. And then I come in on the back side underneath and start putting in some darker value. To get some more paint out here, I'm running out. It's really kind of fun to turn around and see what this looks like on camera, because when I'm up close like this, I really have it's a little hard to see sometimes when you're up close. That's why every once in a while you'll hear me say I want to step back and look at it. So far I haven't stepped back and looked at this at all. So, but I do turn around and look at my monitor here, and I can tell what you're seeing and whether or not it's looking the way I want it to. Some dark lines in here, separate these, make some dark in here. Okay, so if you can see the values change from light to medium to dark, you can start seeing the way I'm creating these things. A little brown in here now. It's kind of fun. I'm not getting bored. I hope you're not. Let's see. With some gray. I want it here. Big rock right here. So I'm kind of letting this dry before I connect them together. That way I'm not getting a lot of cross bleeding. I notice I painted up here and came down here, then came back to this section. It's all part of when you're painting live and you don't want to stop and take the hair dryer and blow dry everything every so often. You jump around the painting a little bit and sort of keep it, let parts dry while you're working on other parts. So this big rock here's got some texture in him. Got some dark spots in there as well. A few cracks in there like that. Come back and get a little more of this reddish brown in here. It's a little bit too, it's almost the same value, and it's going to run together. So I'm going to light this up, put clear water on it, bring it down. At some point I stop looking at the photograph entirely and just kind of rely on the painting to tell me what to do. But nevertheless, this has all been done with a half inch flat brush, folks, so far, all of this, except the sky. I did use a little bit bigger brush, but, okay, here we got some rocks that are sort of laying on their side again. And this I want to make sure that it's soft and rounded. So I keep some of these rocks soft and some are rounded. a little gray rock in here.
Okay, put my lighter color, then come back with my darker tones. So that giving me this little light area here in the middle is sort of helping me tell you that's sort of a rounded rock that's sort of laying on the ground back there, kind of holding some of this stuff up. Okay, where am I here now? This area in here, give me some gray with a little brown in it. I'm using still to grain brown. I'm using ultra burnt umber and burnt sienna. If I want more red in it, I use burnt sienna. If I want more dark brown, I use the burnt umber. And right in here, we're going to come in and pop in another rock that sort of fits in here like this. Then I have a whole bunch of rocks down here that are more gray. I'll come back and separate those for you in a minute. Show you what I'm talking about in here. A little place for water back there. And just to get darker here on the back side there, and spots in here. On the bottom. Okay. Okay. So I'm looking at the rocks on my monitor here to see if they're looking, whether I need some more sharp edges or not. Some cases I could use a few more, maybe some cracks and some things in here to help sort of define some of those rocks. They do have some cracks and crevices in them, but I don't want to overdo that. Okay, over here, this is sort of drying up on me now. Maybe I can put another thing like this in there. I got in there almost too soon before it was still kind of wet. Okay, another gray rock or two. This rock has a gray top on it and a gray front. Like that. And we'll come back and pop in the photograph actually has these rocks almost black here, which is one of the things you have to watch out for when you're painting from photographs. Photographs can deceive you. I'm not putting black in here. I'm putting a brown, a dark brown. with a little bit of neutral tint in it, and rough edge at the bottom if I can make it rough. Under here we've got a few, these could hook these together here. There we go. Maybe I can leave a little water, hook up some water back in there. Outline that rock a little bit and put a couple of cracks and crevices in him. Okay, I have quite a pile of rocks. These areas that are white, I'm going to sort of try to get rid of them now that it's dry. I don't want those, a lot of white specks floating around here. They need to be, they really don't have any bright white highlights on them. Okay, this is all sand now here. There's another big gray rock over here. See if we can get him in. And running right off the page over here. And darken up his backside. There you go. It's a little spot out here. Oh, whoa, I just got under my palette, didn't I? Uh-huh. There you go, folks. What you missed. Okay. This is foam and sand in here, and foam and sand. So now I've got pretty well got my rocks done. I keep messing around, I'll diddle it to death. Okay. I think that's pretty good looking right there. Kind of like the looks of that. There were a couple other rocks and some stuff sitting up here, but I really don't have to paint that stuff in if I don't want. Rock kind of just went right off the page over there. Something like that. Actually, there's a place for people to stand up here and look. There's a fence up there that I didn't paint. Okay, now, what are we going to do? Let's get a round brush and get just a little bit of gray in it and see if I can pop in this fuzzy. I'm going to get more gray in it than that. I think maybe, now that I think about it, I want that to be a little bit wet up there. I want that to be slightly damp. So I'm going to want this to blur and blend. Okay, so I just wet it down very lightly, pick up some gray in my round brush, and see what I can do here to make this look like there's some foam going on up here. This is almost too dark, but I can always add water and lighten it up. It almost looks like a rock, doesn't it? So I dry brush it now up here. If I can get enough little hopefully that's starting to look a little bit like a
water splash. And actually, if I wanted to come back and put in some titanium white over that, I could do that to make that look more white. Kind of areas that are sort of need a few shadows under them too. I bet you I'm taking my palette away, haven't I? Okay, let's put it over here. Might try that white after a bit if I don't like the way this looks. It almost looks like another rock. Not too happy with that. But I can see what I can do here to sort of lighten it up maybe. Sort of yeah, I'll come back and put some white on that after a bit, if I don't forget. Hello, Carol. Thanks for joining. All right, so I'm going to put in just a little more of this greenish gray. That's not very gray. Pick up some of my gray and mix it with my green over here. Dry brush. See how that looks? I'm just barely touching the paper and letting these 300-pound bumps on this paper pull the paint off the brush. And it's giving me this little bit of this frothy look. And I need probably a little bit more brown in it. Get some of my raw sienna here and see if I can get a sandy beach color here. Start putting in there. And I want to put it in a sort of a similar way. The beach does go way out there. Okay. So I could play around and try to get a little bit different beach color, but I'm going to just use this raw sienna, which is a very nice transparent color. And maybe a little bit of brown with it to show the sandy beach here. Pick up a little bit of brown and maybe reflect it into that. Back to the raw sienna. As long as I mix some wet on wet here, sort of get this interesting. This is really back here, it's same way. I got a little froth I want to preserve back there, and I got a little bit of a foam that I'm going to try to preserve in here. So I'm just trying to preserve some foam here. You got to remember you're painting negatively around these foamy areas. And you have to think about leaving some white out. And this actually has a little bit of different color in it, actually, a little bit of bluish color. Not really. Actually, it's got a little bit of this violet in it. Ooh, there's a chunk of violet I don't want. If I can take a little bit of violet and mix it with this raw
raw sienna.
Gives you some nice shadowy light colors back in here.
If you can see that well or not, but it's a little bit hard to see it.
Let's put in a
so you can see the sand, you can see the this some of the shadows in the sand. This violet, which is a complementary color to this yellow, starts filling in a little bit, and it starts to give you a reflection. Might be a reflection like of the sky, that type of thing. So just more water, more paint. Trying to paint around this area that comes in, a foaminess. So we're getting this all down here. Goes up to here. Trying to leave a rough edge as much as I can around this foam that sort of comes in. Up a little of my lavender and pop it in some areas. Gives you a little bit of a change of color, a little bit of a shadow type look here. Okay. More raw sienna and water back here. Another little few spots on it that make it look like we got some foam going on there. In through here, even real rough. This area here is all sort of foamy and purpley, and I don't know what color it is in here. Get a little more purple in there. So mixing up a little bit of my raw sienna with a little bit of my purple here. It's all foamy there. I got a lot of foam in there in this area. So let's just see if I can make it look a little bit like the photograph. When you pull the brush very quickly over the paper, especially if you're painting on a cold press paper, a 300-pound paper, you get these nice little skips where the brush just sort of skips over. If you have too much water in your brush, it won't work, but if you have just the right amount, it will skip over and give you these nice little things that, like I did up here, sort of glistens.
some more.
Okay, so it's easier to do this kind of a painting with oils because you have more control over the whites, and you can put the whites in where you want them and make them sort of look like the foam that's coming up here on the beach. And here you make the foam by skipping the brush and leaving white flecks of paper there. So that's one difference between watercolor and oils, in that you okay, a bit more of this in here in some areas. Close off some of this. Okay, we have a lot of foamy, frothy stuff in here that's has a little bit of gray in behind it. Okay, that looks like a little bit of a something that's sort of rushing up against the rocks there, here, over here. We got some areas that are rushing up against the rocks. Okay, maybe just a little back in here more. Okay, what else can I do here? That thing still bothers me. I did put in a couple of little birds in here. Birds, be careful when you put birds in your paintings. Don't make great big, I'm going to use another brush for that. I'm going to use my rigger for that because I want it to be very thin, very light. Whoops. Got paint all over my brush. Make sure you have enough paint in your brush to make a couple of little wings, but basically up here somewhere I had in, you don't need much, just a, I just went behind my palette again, sorry folks, there we go. Just made little, almost like little check marks up here. Something like that. If you make great big wings on them, they look like they're pterodactyls or something, and they would be, if they flew up close to you, they're supposed to be pretty far out in the water. So if you make the wings too big, if you imagine them coming into shore, by the time the perspective brings them into shore, their wings would be 6 foot wide. So you don't want to make them that way. All right, let's see here. I'm gonna get my white now, my titanium white. Now, for pure transparent watercolorists, white is supposed to be, most of the white that people used to use was is like a gouache. And if you tried to enter that painting into a show, they wouldn't let you put it in if it had gouache in it. So you had to do something else. And Winsor Newton came out with this titanium white that I'm told is acceptable in transparent watercolor submissions and shows. So we'll see. If I'm not going to put this in a show necessarily, but I'm just sort of flicking it up here now in front of these rocks. If you can see that, I just went under my palette again, didn't I? There. So the white is sort of mixing. It is dissolving some of this underneath here. And sort of give me a different texture, a little bit of a little bit of gray in there.
And down here, when I put it on, it's sort of doing the same thing. It's sort of mixing and letting me flick it up, because I'm using a number 4 round here. So I just want to sort of pop in some of this color that goes over what's there, but it does dissolve what's there. So you have to have a lot of paint on your brush to make it work. But little side things like that, flicking it up, like this, helps give it that look of something splashing back there against the rocks. And here, flick it up.
Okay.
Even in here, I can put in a little bit of that probably. Don't want to overdo it, but I do want to see if I can get this to look as realistic as possible with watercolors. It helps outline it just a little so that it looks like it's pulling back a little bit. And a lot of foam and frothiness in here. I'm actually painting over some of these rough textures that I created with this white, titanium white. Almost too much there. It is giving me interesting overlay over the colors that are there. So it's helping these colors. They look like they might be waves out there. Let's see here if this. Some. Okay, I think. I think I want to put in some of that, some spots of like under the foam here. There's some areas of like shadows. Helps sort of define this area a little better. It's almost too much one color out there. So I'm just using this number 4 brush and just sort of putting in some shadows under these foamy areas that are coming in. So that you know they're, if they have a shadow under them, they're basically coming into shore, and some of these ones here are starting to go back out. So I'm going to flick it like this to let you see that there's shadows on the other side of these. Okay. All right, I could keep messing with this for quite a while, probably. I'm still not extremely happy with this big splash up here. Maybe it would have worked better if I had the darker sky behind it. Maybe. I'm going to pop some more color in there and see if I can keep getting that brighter. Like that. I did put in, leave room for a couple of sails out here. I don't know if you're even going to be able to see this. But if I put in a couple of little sailboats out there with a base on them here, you'll be able to tell there might be something out there. A little shadow on the sail, on the right side of the sail. Okay, a couple little sailboats, 3 birds,
big splash of wave. What else can I do here? I think I better stop fiddling with it and pick up my gray color here. Actually, I don't want that brush. I want this rigger. And a grayish brown over here is kind of soft. I'm going to pop in my block signature. Okay, I think that's all I want to do with that. I may come back and play around with this up here again after a while, but right now that's it's going to have to do. So I've got a couple sailboats and a few birds and a lot of rocks, a lot of shadows. So this hopefully is going to help you see how I paint rocks anyway. Hope you give it a chance and give it a try and let me know how you do. So check me out on my Facebook page and check out my website. I will have the sketch of this out there probably in a day or so when I get the video edited. I think I may edit this video and put it out there again, but it's going to be on YouTube for you to watch now, unless I stop showing it to everybody. It'll be there. But the sketch will be out on my website when I get it done, or when I get the website updated. So I think that's all I want to say to you today and show you today. Hope you've enjoyed this little demonstration of a seascape of Cabo San Lucas in Mexico. And Photos for Artists is the website, the Facebook page that I get many of my photographs from now. And they're free of copyright use. They're meant for artists to use and take advantage of. And if you're so inclined, go check it out and see how you like it. And if you find a painting you like, give it a try. So with that said, I think I'm going to say so long for now, and I'll see you sometime later. Thanks for watching. So long. I just realized I could put on a few splatters maybe here. If you sign off now, you'll miss my splatter. That helps a little bit. Just take a loose brush and throw some spots around out there. Don't want to do too much of it, but basically that's all right, there we go. Now I'm done. I'm going to stop streaming, and I will see you next time, folks. Thanks for tuning in again.